Good afternoon, everybody, and on behalf of FICCI, I'd like to welcome you to the session. My name is Deepak Deva, and I'm the co-chair of the FICCI Tourism Committee. It's a great pleasure to have you all here with us today. I believe we are more than two to two and a half thousand people who've registered, and we had a session earlier today, which was also very interesting. But now we're going to have a really interesting session with people who are not from the travel business. You know, so far we've always had sessions with people talking about their pain in the travel business, whether it's hotels, airlines, or travel companies. We today have a very interesting session where we are talking about getting a totally different perspective. So we have our moderator for the session is Dipali Nandwani, who's the editor of Travelgram. Dipali, welcome to the show, and thank you so much for being the moderator on for FICCI. Our panelists are a very interesting lot. There's Ajay Jadeja, the former captain of the Indian cricket team. Ajay, welcome to the show. You've obviously, you've seen things from the other side of the pitch and from various angles, and now you have this situation in travel. So we'd love to hear from you as to what you have to say. We have, of course, Chef Ranveer Barar. Ranveer, we love the way that you've taken Indian food to a different level. I'm going to leave you to tell us how life will change for us in this whole period, and also how we can take tourism to the next level. We have also Deepak Lamba, who's the CEO of Worldwide Media, the president of Times Strategic Solution, and mentor at the Times Center for Learning. Deepak, welcome. And we also will be joined soon by Vikrant Gupta, who's the senior executive editor of the India Today Group. So as you can see, everybody, we have a fantastic panel and a fantastic group of people. I'm sure Dipali is going to conduct this in a manner where everybody gets a chance to speak. Nobody will speak over each other. So Dipali, all yours. Have fun, and we're really looking forward to everybody's views. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Deepak, for such a warm welcome. And thank you to all the panelists, Ajay, Ranveer, Deepak, for being with us today. We have a very accomplished panelist. All of you, I'm sure, travel extensively. And I'm sure all of you must be missing travel and wanting to get back onto the road and to the airports. So I hope we can have like a fantastic discussion on what you are expecting to see as the world opens up. Just for to introduce what we're doing today, the session is attempting to take an alternative perspective on the tourism industry. Before I could start the session, I would request the audience to please post a question on FICCI's virtual conference platform, and we'll take these questions at the end of the session. Going back to the session itself, I was doing a little bit of research on how the last pandemic panned out and what impact it left on the world. The last time the world actually faced something like this was in 1918, which was the influenza pandemic that had left most of the world devastated. But it also offered humanity a perspective on how they needed to change the very systems that had led to the outbreak of this pandemic. A century later, here we are once again dealing with another pandemic of a global nature. While all the industries have been affected, I think the worst affected have been the travel and hospitality industries, which will perhaps be the last to revive also. Yet, everything, I think, is not lost by all estimates. At Travelgram, we have been pursuing reports on how the industries will open, holding conversations with global industry leaders on the challenges that they face while they're opening up again. All research and conversations have shown that there is caution, and yet there is hope. People want to travel. People are looking forward to travel. There's a lot of enthusiasm in the hospitality and travel industry revolving around opening up again to welcome guests and travelers. We set up Travelgram, which is a unique online newsletter-based platform with a view to track how these industries will cope, revive, and ultimately thrive. With that, I would like to invite my first panelist to speak to us. Ranveer, I would take this to you. Why don't you start and tell us your perspective on the situation as we stand and on your outlook towards travel?
Sure. So it's great to be here, in such august company, and it's good to have these discussions right now because maybe we can get certain insights which really help us. Now, there are two perspectives that I'm going to touch on. One is obviously the food and beverage perspective, and the other is a traveling perspective, because I travel a lot for television. I do a lot of travel shows, and traveling is something that I think I'm more of a traveler than a chef these days. But I think, in terms of food and beverage, I think it's more instinctively you sense that that'll recover faster, because your need to go out to your neighboring restaurant or drive to that 1 mile radius and hang out with your friends can be easily satiated, and that's why I'm very, very hopeful of the restaurant part, at least being patronized quicker than the travel. But the way I see it is, I think travel is something that is just going to transform. I don't think we as human beings, we can't stay away from our basic nature of exploration. I think there's a certain transformation that's due, which I feel is great. There's going to be a lot of detail in travel, and the detail will come from the fact that when we're going to do weekend travel, we're going to drive around to places where we can drive around to, maybe avoid long distance travel. We're going to find a lot of detail in our ecosystem that surrounds us. And I think that is something that was, I look at it as that is something that will help us become better people. We say the same thing as chefs, that, if you eat what grows around you, you become better. You eat regional, you eat local. So when you start traveling local, you have a better understanding of local culture. You have a better understanding of how that local culture translates into who you are, what your being is. And those finer details of this micro travel to micro culture, as I like to call it, will eventually, till obviously things get better and we can travel in the long run, but they will eventually make us a better society that appreciates its roots as much as it appreciates the exotic, and as much as it appreciates, the aspiration. I think it'll make us more rooted. The more we travel to a 100-mile radius of what's around us, the more real and the more connected we will get as human beings, as individuals, as a society overall. It'll make us more culturally aware, more responsible, because a lot of where we travel to is not going to be manicured by the travel industry or curated. A lot of times when we travel abroad, it's 80% curation. So you get to see what they want you to see, and you come back sometimes with a semi idea of a real picture. Here, it's difficult to curate a 100-mile drive. You'll get off at the restaurant that you want to get off to. You'll ask questions to people. It's not going to be as curated, as controlled. It'll be more real travel, and it'll make us more real. So I think that until we can figure out life becomes back to normal, that is for me the future of travel. It's exciting because it allows us to focus on who we are. It allowed us to focus on the micro part of our travel infrastructure, and I personally am excited about it, and I think it'll leave an impact for the longer run as well.
Thank you so much, Ranveer. You're absolutely right. I think what it would definitely lead to, and which is fantastic for the Indian industry, whether it's hospitality or the F&B industry, is the fact that we will experiment a lot more within India. The people who travel abroad to Asia or parts of the world in search of food experiences will hopefully now, look into their own backyards. Thank you. Coming to you, Ajay, would you like to take it from here and tell us, what are your views on your approach to travel? What are your views on how this will open?
Hi, everybody. Just hello. And all I want to share is probably, an experience that I've had in the last, 50 odd days. I left on the 9th. In fact, as soon as the borders opened, you could term me as one of the migrants. Labors as well, because I live in Delhi, but I actually come from Jamnagar, Dwarka, where where I'm originally from. So for me, the first opportunity that I had was to get into the car and, as soon as the borders had opened, because I personally felt, yes, we are in these times, we got to be careful, not just for myself, but if I should not be, passing on something that I have. But since I was traveling in my own car, I wasn't expecting to find places on the way to eat. I'm blessed to have played the sport. So I played for Delhi, Haryana, Rajasthan, and I am from Gujarat. So all the drive that I had friends and family all along the way. So maybe I didn't use the travel industry, but my experience was I still could find places where people were still human. And, it wasn't as it's become now. People about 50, 60 days ago were still accepting people without a mask. Whereas, in fact, I was carrying one. I was carrying a whole PPE kit. I didn't know where I was going because it was an unknown. And I think that's the most fantastic thing about travel. If you know where you're going, you know exactly, like Ranveer was just talking about, mostly when it's curated, that's not real travel. Real travel is when you actually go out and explore. So my experience in this period has been that, travel has changed, because I've done this journey not once, but since I was 3 months old, that's when we came to Delhi. So this is a journey that I'm used to. I know about it. I've done it on train. I've done it with flights. We are blessed now to have a flight that goes directly to Rajkot, and then we can drive. But so my experience was that when you were driving, you could see another world. It is not the same that it used to be over a period of time where you had certain places to stop. Now it was open. Some people are open, some people aren't. So I look at it as an opportunity for the travel industry, in fact, to totally go and change. I went to places where I had never been. I went to a travel lodge, which is a jungle lodge. I went stopped at a golf resort. And these places at the moment are probably the safest places to be, because they're all adhering to the norms that have been set out of, sanitization and social distancing. But these places are, say a 1,000-acre place has 40 people. And they are, doing all the sanitation that is required. So travel has changed. We will change how we travel. And I think flights are probably the last place where I would be when it comes to travel. And mode of transport of travel will change. And you'll have to have your personal, whether you have a motorbike that you travel on, or a car that you travel in, or even a bus, a family. I mean, I think what's going to happen is, from being individuals, I think we'll probably become a community travel, is what I look at. I think the future is not individual travels, but probably community travels, whether you call it four people as golfing, partners who are going in one car, or you look at four families who go on a holiday together, where you have a entire bus or an entire bogey that you're going to book, depending on what you can book, or probably, small aircrafts. People who can afford it would probably be hiring private jets of 10, 12, 15 people. So starting from, what you can afford, it's going to end up, the next few years are probably going to be community travel rather than individual travel, which I had been used to all my life. Pick up your bag, go to the airport, take a flight and go to any part of the world. I think that's going to be a long way away.
Thank you so much for that insight, Ajay. You're absolutely, that was a really interesting insight, because you have traveled during this time, unlike a lot of us. And
5,000 kilometers.
Yeah, 5,000 kilometers. that is a goal that all of us now have to put in front of us as India opens. 5,000 kilometers to start with. But it's amazing, your insight that you have offered into how things are, opening in the whole experiences. It should put a lot of people at ease, people who want to travel but are worried about traveling. So insights like this actually help people to say, if you can do it, maybe I can attempt. Maybe if not 5,000 kilometers, I can go at least 200 kilometers or 300 kilometers and see how that goes. Thank you, Ajay. Inviting Deepak now. Deepak, would you like to add on to the insights offered by Ranveer, Ajay? Give us some of your own insights.
Oh, I hope I'm audible.
Yes, now you are. Yeah, you are on mute. You are.
I'm audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay, great. So, hi, everybody. And I think Thanks for having me be a part of this panel. Just one caveat or one sort of disclaimer that I will make, Deepak, when he was introducing us, was saying that none of us have any sort of stake in the travel business. One small but important business that I do run is the Lonely Planet magazine business. So that's very much involved in the travel industry. So I just wanted to put that disclaimer out there. But having said that, I'm not here to spout any sort of gyan or mantra on what we should do as a community or as individuals about travel. When in fact Manish reached out to me and asked me whether I can be a part of this panel, I actually went and stood in front of my refrigerator. You know, my wife and me are avid travelers, and everywhere we go, we have this sort of tradition. We pick up these magnets from all across the world, wherever we've gone, and we put them on our refrigerator desk. And I was just seeing the front of my refrigerator, trying to get some inspiration so I can talk some sense here this afternoon. And I think two things sort of stuck out for me. One, if you look at the evolution of humans or mankind, it's been on the basis of curiosity, right? Today, we are trying to do space exploration. Our intrinsic nature of curiosity is not going to stop. As we become smarter and more aware of our surroundings, we're definitely going to bring those pieces of knowledge into our being so that we can be better travelers. So I think if I was to coin a mantra of sorts, and I can't sometimes help myself because at the end of the day, I'm a marketeer. I think today, the way we travel, I think will be on the basis of three S's. That will be safety, sensibility, and sustainability. Obviously, we're all worried for not only ourselves, but our loved and dear and loved ones around us. So, both Ranveer and Ajay said that I think hyperlocal travel is going to replace the, when I was seeing my fridge, I said, look, I've seen the world, but how much of my own country have I seen? And I'll put my hand up saying, guilty as charged, because in our quest to experience new cuisines, new experiences, new forms of living, etc., I realized that I probably would have experienced 1/10 of my own country as opposed to experiencing the world. This gives you a great opportunity, and that opportunity also comes from a little bit of necessity, because I don't think I'd be very eager to jump on an airplane anytime soon. So I think hyperlocal travel around to explore, what is, if I'm from around Bombay, what can I explore from around my region? The other bit is, and I think the Prime Minister and the government is trying to do their own bit to try and raise consciousness about businesses. So whether it is homestays, whether it is seeing how you can travel in a sustainable way, I think we'll all have a little bit more sensibility subconsciously put into our minds, saying, can we travel and maybe add 2% of good if we can? The enjoyment will, of course, be, we've traveled for sake of recreation, but can we also contribute? So can I do a nice homestay? Of course, it has to meet my criteria of safety, sensibility, etc. But can I then start exploring other means of travel that I would perhaps otherwise not be accustomed to? The one, on a very, very light note, I think the one part of travel that may take a temporary dip when the borders do open is romantic travel. Because I think we've been cooped up with our better halves for far too long in confined spaces. So we will welcome all the sort of other friends, etc., that we've only spoken to via phone, etc. So to add to that point, I think that micro community travel will definitely be in vogue. I hope my wife's not listening to this.
Thank you, Deepak. Thank you for the insights on hyperlocal travel. You put some very good points on sustainability. And yes, I guess friends are going to benefit from the time when we start traveling again and wanting to see them again. I'm going to open some questions. I will touch upon some of the points that you have raised a little later, but a couple of questions for all three of you. I wanted to ask you that when you actually start traveling with your friends, family, Ajay has already started, so he could offer better insights. But what would you expect, say, from a destination or a hotel to offer you? What is the topmost on your mind for this, whether it's safety issues, hygiene issues? Please touch upon it. Can I take this to Ranveer?
Sure. So I think mindfulness is what I'd expect in the first place. I get very scared when you try and show me that you're overtly cautious. it just, to me, as a place, you're not prepared if you're overtly cautious and there's somebody behind me always with the sanitizer bottle in their hand. But definitely a sense of mindfulness towards the subject, which shows in deeper aspects, which shows in infrastructural aspects, whether it's a destination or even just a hotel, how you sort of adjusted the bigger infrastructure and the deeper processes to give me a feeling that you're mindful and respectful of what is going on, rather than have you just done a lot and a lot of it, which is extremely intimidating to look at, but at the end of it, you're trying to work the same way like it was pre-COVID, with just a few tweaks here and there. I think you can sense a mindful adaptation or a DNA change in an organization. All of us have worked with organizations. You can sense that. You can sense whether it's a process change or it's just something that is a little more superficial. I think that's the first thing that I look for. Second is, and very rightly Deepak put it, is the sense of responsibility. I think we've reached a stage where sustainability and responsibility is extremely, extremely crucial to the survival of travel. And if you're in the travel business, whether you're a destination or whether you're an organization that supports the destination, like a hotel or a, you know, whatever organization that is, I think the responsibility towards, one, the person coming in, two, the environment. I think the fact is, all of us now realize that we're all interconnected to each other. We cannot live in isolation. Doesn't really matter if I have a COVID or not. I think everybody's equally responsible. And what COVID has done is subconsciously tied us together in saying, hey, you know, just me doing anything is not enough. All of us have to do it together. And that responsibility, which sort of hopefully translates to sustainability, is something that the discerning traveler will definitely look out for.
Thank you so much, Andy. That was a very interesting point, because, you know, at Travelgram, while we are writing on hotels and travel, and everybody's talking about contactless dining, contactless travel, whereas your point is very interesting, that yes, we have to be safe, but we also have to keep the feeling of community going, the warmth going. So that's something the travel and hospitality industries may have to ponder over. I take this question to you, Ajay, particularly since you have traveled so much. What is it that you are, what is it that you're expecting from the hotels or and the destinations, or what have you seen and what would you like to change or, you know, hold on to?
I think for me, like I've already, been traveling. I think most important is the mindset, because if you really think of it, each one of us, we are all blessed people who are on the panel, and the places that we stayed or we ate or we stopped, even while driving or even at the airport. I mean, you know, some of us are blessed to be in certain lounges and not in other places. We were already segregated. And we were picking places that each one of us feel is clean enough or hygienic enough, or we never stop at a place where it's even before COVID, which one of us would, you know, be driving around and have two options with a dhaba which looks dirty and a dhaba that looks cleaner. Where would you have gone? So I think it's that's nothing new. I don't think I expect anything different. Like with any industry in the world, I mean, you will always have stratas of service that's provided to you. But I guess we are probably blessed to be in a strata where we were always, you know, in a hotel where it's exclusive when you went into your room. Only difference now is that, you know, when I go, into a private space in a hotel or at a restaurant, I may not have cleaned the table myself, or, you know, the switches that I'm going to touch, or the phone that exists in a room. It was always clean. You presumed it was clean. And I still think the hotel industry probably even before this used to do it. Maybe it wasn't sanitized with alcohol and the sanitizers that, you know, but you went to those hotels or you stayed in those places because you felt that they were, you know, safer, cleaner and more hygienic. So I don't see any different post-COVID. I still look at life the same way. If I wanted to be in public, the only place I feel, and it probably is affected to tourism or not, is the only place that you never had a choice is, say, if I was driving, I would, you know, stop at, you know, Ajmer Dargah, or I would go to the mandir at Dwarka. So those are the only places, whether it was clean or not, you ended up going. But a hotel or a restaurant was always picked, or a place that you were going to stop was always picked depending on your own personal hygiene level that you looked at. And I don't see it any different post-COVID, except that I carry a cleaning instrument or a towel or a little ultraviolet light as well now, that before I use a mug, I want to, you know, make sure that it's clean. Which tells, what does it tell you about me and the situation, that I'm not trusting even the highest quality that's being provided by somebody. I think it's unfortunate that we've stopped trusting each other. And when somebody, earlier when we went to a hotel, we trusted a certain kind of service and cleanliness from a place. I hope that comes back, because at the end of the day, the whole industry or people working in that industry also are responsible. But it's just that, in at least I can only talk about myself. In my mindset, I'm not ready to trust everybody at the moment. I hope that changes very soon.
Thank you, Ajay. So this is probably a warning to the hospitality industry that most important thing right now is to create trust among consumers, to tell them and get the message out either through campaigns or other methods on how they can be trusted to deliver an experience that is not just excellent but also safe. A very tall order, but I'm sure Indian hospitality industry is up to it. Deepak, can I come to you now? Again, the same question. What are your expectations from a destination or hotel when you start traveling? What do you want them to do?
So I'll try and break this up into two parts, the travel part and then the experience part once you've reached your destination, right? And I fully agree with Ajay and Ramit that, you know, ultimately, you know, we are blessed to come to have a certain standard because of, you know, whatever we've done, to enjoy a certain sense of exclusivity, if I can call it that, for want of a better word. But I think if you have to try and see this as an industry takeoff, then we've got to look at this old, you know, what we all studied in school. I remember very little of what I studied in school, but this Maslow's theory of hierarchy. So, you know, the lowest common denominator, how can you sort of, how can that start getting influenced? Now let's take a case where all of us panelists, we take off and go to whatever destination we want to. We check into the a fairly exclusive sort of place. So the immediate part of the travel and the roof over your head at night is taken care of. Yet the experience comes in the places that Ajay was talking about, you know, the dargahs, the mandirs, etc. And here, I think it's very, very important to, you know, there is a carrot and a stick, and they both have to go together. You have to have, you know, if you're talking about community living, then there are various aspects of the community that perform their own roles. They're meant to perform their own roles. And very often we would see this in the past, and I'm not trying to point a finger at any administration, because, you know, to manage, Ajay will tell you to manage 16 people is a task, or I can tell you to manage 1,000 people in my team is a task. So to imagine managing 30 lakhs of people, it's a very, very tall order. But that is your karma. Unfortunately or fortunately, that's what you're supposed to do. And to try and avoid the shortcuts that we've all sometimes also, you know, been a part of, you know, slip him some money and get to the front of the line, or all of those things need to sort of specifically, because, you know, the danger of personal safety has never been more heightened than it was as it is today. So shortcuts which may lead to temporary comfort for a certain section of society may end up actually adding fuel to the fire for a larger system. So I would look for, you know, all the things that my two esteemed sort of co-panelists have said in terms of the hygiene, the safety, etc. is a given. But can the administration, I would really, really look and try and research that the place I'm going to, is the administration equipped enough to make the experience a safe one? Because otherwise, all the things that if we do everything right for whatever is in our control, but still have a stumbling block when it comes to where the caretaking of a particular experience is in the hands of somebody else, we may still end up falling short. So I'll break this into two aspects.
Thank you, Deepak. That is a very interesting insight, because it's not just the hotels and destinations that have to change, it is us also who have to change. We have to put our privilege aside and become, as Ajay has said and Anveer has said, a part of a whole ecosystem, a part of the whole community, and work according to that. Each of you gentlemen have touched upon one very important aspect of travel that everybody is talking about in terms of sustainability and responsible travel. Now, as India understands it, we don't even understand the tip of the iceberg as far as this is concerned. We still continue to believe that just not using plastic bottles to drink from is all about sustainability. So I would like to put the question back to you. When you say about sustainable travel, what are you looking for? What are you expecting? Ranveer, if you could take this question, particularly not just sustainability in terms of travel, but also sustainability in terms of F&B, because how easy it is for restaurants and hotels to be sustainable, in the supply chain, on the kind of food and experiences they offer?
I'll touch on more on the F&B part, because I'm sure Deepak will add on a lot to the travel part. But I think inherently as a society, we are a no-waste society. We've grown up with our grandmothers sort of telling us to scrape that last bit of the mango. The gutli needs to be wiped before it goes into the bin. Even then, some cultures dry that gutli, take out the seed and make a sabzi of that mango seed also, right? So inherently, I think the answer to sustainable living is something that you just sort of cut back to 50 years, is something that already lies there in our society. And a lot of what has happened in 50 years, I like to call it the Western system of sustainability, which we've tried to look at. We went to look for sustainable wines before we could look for sustainable agriculture in our backyard. Farmers that were committing suicides because we couldn't create an ecosystem of sustainable agriculture for them. I think we just rushed the word sustainability, took it from the West and ran with it. We forgot the fact that it is basically genetically encoded in each one of us. And I'm sure that all of us, we probably are the last generation who can hold on to that system of sustainability, because we've seen that. Our children probably haven't seen those times. I give everybody the example of, all of us come from families where every battery before it gets thrown has a certain life cycle. It goes to, after the torch, it goes to the transistor, it goes to the clock. We've seen how to make most of every resource. It's in our DNA. I think the answer to sustainability has to be indigenous. What COVID is going to do is, because of a lot of import bans and a lot of inability to look outward, we are going to be forced to look inwards. And I'm really, really hopeful that we will sort of go back and look for those solutions that exist in our culture and remove the Western system of sustainability the Western lens of sustainability that we are so trying to find our answers in, that we'll change our books of sustainability, as I like to call it. This whole farm to table, and I keep talking about it, till now our farm to table has been a select few restaurants, and the farm part has been a select few urban farmers who understand the concept. That's not farm to table. It's basically a 0.00001% of farmers that get affected by that farm to table. That's something that we took from Australia or a few other countries and said, well, I traveled there and let me do a farm to table. Let me call up somebody who speaks very good English. He can come and talk to my guests. He's an urban farmer. I think we will be forced to look deeper to understand what an Indian farmer is. He can't speak English. He can't sell his produce. But for us to genuinely form a chain of sustainability, we need to talk to him only and start from him more than start from. So it's, I always say, it's, it was humko syllabus wahi hai, kitab badalni padegi sustainability ki. And that I think is the dying, because we will not get those answers there anymore. Typically because we won't get that food to work with.
Anvi, that's a very interesting viewpoint, and it's really exciting to think that we can go back to our old traditions. Maybe our chefs in the hotels and restaurant space can actually look for a lot of our grains and ingredients and vegetables and raw materials, which we had just lost because, you know, which had stopped growing, eating, consuming, because we were so focused on what the West told us. I would want to put just one more question to you.
How do you think culinary travel will change?
I think the experiences will become smaller and more. I think it's, food is an offshoot of culture, much like art, much like performing arts, much like painting. Cuisine is basically an extension of culture, which is sort of, which is the foundation is agriculture. So culture, jo hai, agar agriculture nahi hota, to culture, shabd hi agriculture se aata hai. If you, every culture is purely based on sowing and harvest. Every culture starts from there. The joy of the anticipation of sowing and the joy of harvest. So the foundation of culture and everything you do comes from agriculture. Cuisine is the primary outcome of agriculture. So to answer your question, I think our travels are going to become more micro-cultural and hence more micro-cuisine focused, typically because of the inherent culture-cuisine connection.
Thank you, Tanvi, so much for these wonderful insights. I'll take this to Ajay. Ajay, again to you, what would you expect from responsible and, from responsible and sustainable travel? What do you expect from destinations and hotels that call us themselves sustainable? Or could you take that question?
Not sure, because I don't think I till today have I've traveled around the world, but I don't think I've ever made a choice going to a destination or being at a destination just because it was a sustainable place. Maybe I'm not a responsible citizen in the world, but
none of us
are. Like Ranveer just explained, I think there are terms that are used, but actually they may not be as sustainable. I think, you know, people had lives which were more rooted to local areas and they were more sustainable 30, 40, 50 years ago, even when they didn't use the word sustainable. Because, as he mentioned, agriculture, in the last 50 days I've spent on a farm and trying to figure out what's happening with the farming. I think, maybe a little off the topic, but reason why probably we are not, even in small places or small little village that where I was, people are not self-sustainable. The reason why is because people don't farm different things anymore. The entire village at the moment is only farming peanuts because that's what gets them the most money. So the farmers there, including myself, are farming things that they're not consuming. They're farming things to be sold out there in the world. And so as soon as you transport that, it doesn't stay sustainable. So, the terms may be sustainable, but I don't think, unless, like Ranveer said, from the farm to the table, even at the farm, I wasn't getting things that I was eating were not from the farm, whereas we have enough space, we have enough, not just from my farm, even the entire village. So, I think the way of life has changed over the few years, and people like us who live in the city and who actually are farming and are on the ground have a big difference in the way we even look at things. And, the same terms are looked differently there and differently here. The reasons for trying to achieve a goal, which is, I'm blessed. I think we're in a blessed time, whereas our children, my kids are probably more conscious about, sustainability and, being green in life and doing the right things rather than me. But there is a disparity between how we look at a certain term, and the actual user or actual producer looks at it differently. So, and I've never been to one of those sustainable places, so I would probably be the last person to actually make a comment saying, what am I expecting from a sustainable place? I'll tell you one thing. I like to go to places, like even in this travel where I've been, I like to go to places because if I'm going to go there, I want that cuisine. I don't want to go to, Italy and ask for bajra ka rotla and lasan ki chutney. I want to go to, Lamba to have bajra ka rotli and lasan ki chutney, and go to Italy and have risotto. So for people who want to travel, I think they need to be clear what they are actually going for, rather than looking at that term and saying, oh, I am a responsible citizen and I'm going to a sustainable place. There ain't no sustainable place when it comes to the service and the quality that you and I are expecting or are provided. Because all the alcohol that's been used today to sanitize the place is going to be out there somewhere in that field or in that hotel when it's washed out. It's going to stay within us. So I think rather than going towards sustainability, in fact, this COVID has sent us away and got more alcohol into our system. Not maybe this way, but in other forms.
That's a very interesting insight, Ajay, because I remember I was just chatting with a restaurateur, I won't name him, a couple of days ago. And he told me, what are we talking about sustainability? We are drinking single malt that comes from Scotland and we are flying it down and we are spending, the amount of carbon in the air that we're using to fly it down.
We don't get it. The only place in India, we are all one country, but in India, we don't get any alcohol supposedly in Gujarat. So if you're talking about, one country, let's get some alcohol into Gujarat as well.
Gujarat is the only
that will help the travel and tourism industry in Gujarat for sure, I can assure you.
So this is like an advice to the Gujarat travel and tourism industry, or maybe they're more sustainable. I take this question to Deepak. Deepak, responsible travel, what are your expectations from a destination or a hotel?
Yeah, so it's been fascinating listening to both Ajay and Ranveer. For me, I try and sort of peel the layers back of the onion to try and see if I can arrive at the root of what this is. And I think in my mind, it's somewhat clear that as we've grown to become more affluent or as more comfortable as a society, it's been at the bane of the so-called sustainability that we see it, because we've not bothered about it so much as long as it is sort of served its purpose to us. But if you look at what this pandemic has done to a strata of society that perhaps none of us belong to on this panel, if I look at, the staff that used to come to work at my house and the common man on the street, I think the fact that there is a cash crunch because of the economy already having shrunk, and anybody who says otherwise is talking not from his mouth. Clearly, if I can see a certain level of, for me, sustainability means trying to juice something till it has been able to give you all that it possesses. Right? For me, that is my definition of sustainability. And I see that increasingly you see that a lot of people are trying to make their buck stretch, make their dollar stretch a bit. Sustainability ka dusra pehlu agar aap dekhenge to it comes from need. We don't do anything without a need having been there, and it's an adversity that when you start to look at invention and reinvention. You will never look at reinvention or invention when the going is good, which is why I started by saying that comfort and affluence is has been the bane of sustainability, because when you can afford it, when you can get it, you don't think twice about the damage three levels prior to what that action will cause you. So I think today safety is a core concern for you, irrespective of your strata of society. So when certain points like say safety or hygiene, etc., start becoming universal, then you will look for invention and reinvention, etc., in those categories. And luckily, touch wood, for a lot of us, it's still not been a question of, due to this pandemic, about where the next meal is going to come from. But chances are, I was having this chat with Sri Narayan Murthy Ji just 3-4 weeks ago. And he told me, Deepak, that, if in case in the next 4 or 5 weeks, we're not able to get over this pandemic and start opening up our cities, are the lockdown is going to kill more people in India than the pandemic will. There is no doubt about it. May not be for people like us, but agar you cannot earn your livelihood from a legit source, doesn't mean you will go to bed hungry. So it's a ticking time bomb for us. So it is in those situations, sorry, I digress slightly, but it's in these situations that, you know, that bring back values of trying to juice or extract the fullest value of something and then try and ensure that it is a repetitive cycle. For me, that is sustainability. I think life has a very weird way of teaching us all lessons that we tend to forget when we, in our own heads, tick mark that we are doing really well. So this is yet another way of life teaching us a lesson that you don't know anything yet, buddy. It's very tough for me to, I can look back and comment on these things, but if you ask me, so what will let it happen in the next 6 months? I'm as clueless as all of y'all, perhaps even more so.
Thank you, Deepak. That's a very hoping thought. But I would also like to, you know, ask you as the head of a media organization, how would representation of travel, how would travel writing change, and how should it change? How should it change to also take into factor the concerns of the travel and the hospitality industries who probably need the support of the media at this point more than anybody else? How should they approach travel, the communication they send out through media channels like yours?
Thank you so much, Dipali, for asking me, because the first thing I'm going to do is plug Lonely Planet and say, please download the latest episode of Lonely Planet.
Sorry, that was on my intention, but you're welcome.
I was waiting for this. Yeah, I have to sing for my supper. So, no, honestly, what we've been trying to do is, through Lonely Planet, what we've been trying to do is try and get people experience to so-called virtual travel. Now, virtual travel by no stretch of imagination will become a substitute to the actual experience of travel. But it just tries to, and I would, this again requires the entire travel ecosystem industry and led by the government, who actually, for certain places, like I was chatting with the collector of a fairly prominent tourist-focused destination in Rajasthan just 2 weeks ago. And he was telling me about, hardly any effect from COVID, etc. But, they've got 26 live cases in that city. I'm talking about Jaisalmer. But having said that, there is no travel because Jaisalmer is a tiny speck in the overall ecosystem of all the other places that we need to travel. So what we as media need to do is try and talk about, so if we all of us have said that, for example, hyper-local travel will become a reality. We would rather explore places in and around us rather than look at that exotic destination across a sea or an ocean. Then how do we start bringing those into prominence? How do we start focusing on the experiences that some of these places may have to offer? What can we give as tips to traveler or cheat codes to traveler, whatever terminologies you use, ultimately, if we can offer them some guides to being better travelers, more sensible travelers, try and put in their head that, doing this may have, not only will it get you to enjoy, but will also lead to XYZ benefit for the local economy. If we can start doing a bit of these, and more importantly, start again, like I said, at the top of all of these things sits our primal fear of safety. And if you can start to address those safety concerns on what you need to do to be safe, then I think media is doing their bit to try and push this. But please understand that media can talk and disseminate information. We will not be able to actually implement those on ground. And for the industry to sort of kickstart, the administration needs to really, really step in to ensure that there is no mismanagement and the rules are being adhered to as a one-size-fits-all. Right? There cannot be any leverages given to certain players, etc. It's just, if you do a lot of this, and we as media then start talking about all of this happening on a regular basis, automatically it takes public confidence levels up. And right now, you don't need to take the public confidence levels up too high for them to want to travel. They're anyways itching. Give them half an excuse at least to make sure that they get out of their homes.
Thank you. So that's an advice coming from a very veteran media personality and head of a media house. I hope to be travel and
I must also correct you on one thing. There is only one head of this media house, or two heads. Their surnames are not Lamba. I'm just a salaried employee. Okay, carry on, sorry.
Thank you. Ranveer, there's a question for you from the audience. How can one sustain food business and small hotels during the pandemic?
I think what's really important for small food businesses is to understand that they're working with the biggest strength that the big food businesses don't. The strength is the ability to change, because they don't have to write an email to their boss who will get an approval from his boss for the smallest of changes. That's one. The second is, I think it's because small food businesses cater to a smaller set of people who, and they are more personal in nature. They should use that personal in nature approach to at least stay in touch with their clients and make sure that they are reaching out to them instead of the client. We should forget about the client reaching, the customer coming to your restaurant for some time to come. I think, all of us need to get to the customer. And smaller businesses have the advantage that they know every customer by name, because that's why they're nimble, they're personal, and they have to use these strengths to sort of enthuse that trust back, which is easy for them to do as compared to a lot of large restaurant businesses that can sometimes be intimidating, impersonal, and less nimble in terms of being able to change. I think smaller businesses, once they transform themselves based on these trends, have a better chance of sustaining in these times as compared to a lot of big businesses, for whom making small changes is a big deal.
Thank you, Ranveer. I hope there are some small businesses hearing us today and can take some inspiration. Before I hand this over to Deepak, I have one question to all three of you. The three of you can quickly answer because we are running out of time. India, earlier on in the session today, I was hearing about somebody had said that maybe India should, states in India should have travel bubbles between each other. States like Odisha, which are pretty much easier on the COVID scene, which is not bad over there, should have travel bubbles with other states which are also doing well on the COVID front. As travelers, do you think establishing travel bubbles between two states would make it easier for you to make a decision to travel? Ajay, would you like to take this one?
Sorry, I didn't get your question.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, but I couldn't.
I said that earlier in the session today, there was somebody suggesting that there should be a travel bubble between states that are not badly afflicted by COVID. Maybe Odisha or something, and something else, maybe Chhattisgarh, for instance. As a traveler, would it make it easier for you to travel? I mean, I know you have traveled extensively, but if you put yourself in the shoes of a regular traveler, would having a travel bubble like this between two states, where the hotels are also involved in it, would it make it easier decision to travel?
I think it'll depend a lot how personally people look at. Primary concern at the moment is safety. So I think when it comes to safety to somebody's life, the travel is not going to be a travel experience where they just want to go on a holiday, unless they feel that's a safer place than being at home. So I don't know whether that would affect, but certainly yes. I mean, if there is a bubble where you've not had any cases, it would probably be the first place on my mind to go for pleasurable travel as well. Because at the end of all this, the reason why we are also all talking is, it all starts with that safety. How safe are we first? We've just about, in the last 4 or 5 months figured out how safe you can keep your own house and what comes inside the house. And I think travel is not just for pleasure. I think a lot of people are traveling for, they need to travel. There's work, there's family, you have elder generation living in some other town, you want to go and visit them. People have not, I don't, the, even the government or policymakers, I don't want to It's not about government. But people are considering not that as essential. I mean, I think it is essential for me to go and see my grandmother or my mother or my father. It is as essential for me as it is for you to run your business or run your office. If you are allowed to go out and, you know, function in 10% or 20% in your office space, how do you expect me not to go and see my family and expect? So there is a lot more travel that's going to happen. And that travel is also going to be utilized by the travel industry. Because say, like when I traveled from here to Jamnagar, there are hotels. If they were open, I would stay there. If there were restaurants that were open, I would eat there. So these travel places need to be looked beyond just, you know, holiday travelers. And, you know, in our country, or especially where I come from, that highway from Somnath to Dwarka, unfortunately, 95% of our travelers can't travel for next few years because 20-year-olds don't go to mandirs. It is only my great-grand-aunt and aunt, 60-year-old aunts, who are going there. And if they are not allowed to get out of their homes, how do you expect any infrastructure that already exists in the travel industry there to function? So travel is not just a pleasurable travel, especially in India. I think we need to look at travel much wider. It's a necessity. I think it's one of the necessities that you need to add into travel. It could be just to see my mother. I mean, she might be in another city. I think it is necessity for me. And that's how I look at travel. And if you're looking only at holiday travel, then I think we are looking at a minuscule amount of travel that happens in this country.
Thank you, Ajay, so much. I'm not sure if I have the time to put the same question to Deepak and Ranveer. Can I just quickly ask them for their view? Do we have the time? Yeah?
You're at 5:13.
Yeah, quickly, okay. Deepak, if you can give us a fair idea on what you expect from a travel bubble. I mean, how does that help you?
No, I mean, I'll echo Ajay's sentiments. I think whether, you know, travel is not homogeneous. So my needs for travel might be adventures. My parents' needs for travel might be spirituality. Ranveer's need for travel, I'm not saying that just because he's in the food business, but he could just be a foodie and he would want to do the food trail and so on and so forth, right? So travel is different things to different people. But all of this that I've just spoken about is just leisure travel. I need to travel to grow my business. Otherwise, I cannot take care of my employees, etc. I cannot, I mean, and I today spend my day waking up, starting to do web conversations such as this with my clients, with my teams, etc. It is nowhere coming near the surface of what you could do if you were sitting in front of them, right? I'm not saying if all else remains the same, we'd still be at 90% of business, but I don't believe we are at our productive best. I mean, we are trying to make the most or the best of a bad situation. Obviously, that is what we'll all do. But whether it is for work, whether it is for leisure, you need to travel. You need to meet other people. Otherwise, I mean, you're not in a cocoon. You can't do everything on your own. So the sooner that, I think there's next steps, we have to start. When I was hearing Ajay talking about going to meet his mother, my parents stay in Pune. My dad's been a dialysis patient for very long, and it was eating away at me of not being able to even going in. Not that I'll help him in his dialysis, but just being there. And sir, e-pass lena padega ye wo. And then finally I said, yaar, main press wala hoon. Mere se kya e-pass? And then I got those things done. But to my utter shock, I was not checked even once, and I've gone there twice in the last 2 weeks. And there was not a single person checking me. And then obviously my fears of safety come right back in front. So it is high time that, and through people like Vicky and all, and I know guys that y'all also have your task cut out because the government is grappling with 10 things or 10 industries that they need to kickstart. I don't know where travel and tourism sits in the hierarchy. Chances are it may not be at the very top of the list. But until you have a standard operating procedure which differentiates between various forms of travel, but does not shut the door, provided those procedures are being met with and complied with, in order to ease the reopening of physical contact with people, whether as individuals or as bodies, how will you even start to sort of start thinking about rekindling the economy? So the first step is, and which is why I guess Fiki is today doing forums such as this, is to try and get the knowledge to present a white paper to the administration to say, here are the various facets of travel and tourism. Here are some of the recommended SOPs that we want to put in place for different types of travel. Rather than doing a blanket shutdown, irrespective of what your need for travel is. I think we've got to start putting some, this will not happen overnight, but keep iterating, but at least make an attempt in that direction.
Thank you so much, Deepak. You're absolutely right. I think the administration needs to get it right. Ranveer, I have exactly 1 minute left. I have to invite Dr. Suri to close this. We're running out of time. So just in 1 minute, would a travel bubble help you?
I don't think, I think a blanket travel bubble is as dangerous as a blanket travel ban. I think, you know, I'm just basically echoing what's been said before me. I don't think any blanket travel bubble can solve for anything like a blanket travel ban did not solve for much. I think we need to sort of go a little bit deeper and understand and define the word essential. At least for the next 3-4 months in times to come. Because this is what it is. And if this is what we have to live with, then the definitions need to be sharper. And, you know, we can't, I just feel that a blanket travel bubble will not work.
Thank you so much, Ranveer. Dr. Suri, please take over from here. Thank you for all your wonderful insights.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Dipali. Thank you. I mean, you guys have been absolutely wonderful, you know, and we've been here. We had a lovely inaugural this morning, and in the inaugural, we had our Mantri Ji there. The reason for doing this conclave is pretty much as what all of you have just echoed. Should there be a blanket ban? Should there be a bubble? How do the states coordinate with each other? Because all the states have their own individual aspects and their own individual rules and regulations. So while we feel, you know, I mean, I personally gung-ho about the fact that it's the domestic travel we should actually kickstart, because, you know, the hospitality and the travel business, it has such deep ramifications, and the ripple effect goes down so deep, down to the little chai wala on the roadside as well, that we feel that the economy will get kickstarted. However, we are in a crucial time, and it's extremely difficult for one state and the other state to be able to understand and coexist. So hopefully what we are trying to do with this conclave, and I have to say that we've had fabulous response, and we've got a lot of people, more than 2,000 people who've actually logged in, is to get a sense of how do we react going forward. This is, the virus is here to stay for a while till we don't get a vaccine. How do we get people's confidence up to a level whereby people are able to travel, not just necessarily to meet their parents, but actually do leisure travel, to get away from the humdrum and to go perhaps to a destination where they can be out and about in the open air, the wellness destinations, which are something that people are looking forward to. Also areas where you can drive to, where you don't have to get into a train or into an aircraft. So drivecations, as we call them, are something that are there in the pipeline. So I have to thank you all immensely. Thank you very much, Ajay, for giving your point of view. It was wonderful to hear you. Ranveer, always you know, very practical and very dot on. Deepak, your pragmatic approach is absolutely fantastic. And I really appreciate the way all of you, and we did this deliberately. Mm-hmm. We wanted an opinion which was away from all of us sitting in doom and gloom and the bureaucrats and all of them. We wanted an opinion, and we wanted to hear from people who are actually the people that need to be traveling or would want to travel. And Dipali, fantastic job. Thank you ever so much. It was wonderful to have you do this. I'm going to say goodbye to you, all of you. Stay safe, stay healthy. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much,
guys. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much. Thank you.